Hello, my name is Danny Nolan and I'm the Director of ChassisSim Technologies. And welcome to this latest episode of Dan's Vehicle Dynamics Corner. And ladies and gentlemen, what we're going to be talking about today is something that I've been very, very remiss in not covering, and that is the subject of how do you use transient lap time simulation? And in particular, how do you use it properly? Because one of the great traps I see with young players is that they'll get something like ChassisSim, and then what they'll do is they'll then go off, crazily use it. But what they'll do is they'll get themselves lost in certain little rabbit holes in terms of how they actually employ this. And really, this is what I want to address to today. So, first things first, one thing to really point out is that transient lap time simulation represents a fundamentally different challenge to the more traditional forms of simulation that we know. That is, when you're doing either track replays, when you're doing finite element analysis, to a lesser extent CFD in particular, and also when you're using pseudo-static lap time simulation as well. And really, the nail here, and this is probably one of the biggest traps for young players, is that what works for one method of simulation doesn't necessarily translate to the other method of simulation. We'll talk and we'll speak more to that shortly. But the other thing too that we really want to nail down in this video is the appropriate way you should be using a tool like ChassisSim. So let's get started. First things first, and I really want to sort of nail this because in some respects, this is very much a follow-on video from one of the most watched videos on the ChassisSim YouTube channel, which is how you interpret simulated data. Now, and I really want to remind the viewers about what separates simulated data from actual data. Okay, the changes are always smaller. Here's one. Reason one, the nature of the tire model vis-a-vis in terms of when you start making those changes, the actual changes in the forces aren't that big. And I speak to that at length in that video about how to interpret simulated data. Reason two, a simulator is omnipotent and has no concept of its own mortality. It always knows where the grip is. And also too, it has no concept that if it gets it wrong, it's going to make a $1 million mess in the wall. So consequently, your simulated changes are going to show up as cornering speeds. And really, that's the key difference between simulated and actual data, and really I want you to sort of keep that in mind as your compass as we start going through. Okay, traps for young players, correlation. Ladies and gentlemen, if I had $5 for the amount of time I have seen teams, people who are new to ChassisSim waste months on correlation without actually employing it, I would not be here giving this tutorial, ladies and gentlemen. I would be retired to a subtropical paradise, living the life of a gentleman of leisure. So, here are some rough rules of thumb that you need to understand for correlation. If you're between 80 to 120k an hour, you're looking at a delta between 1 to 2k. If you're between 120 to 160k for your mid-corner speed, 2 to 3k is good enough. 160k or over, 3 to 4k an hour is more than sufficient. The exception that proves the rule for this is when you're simulating ovals and super speedways, because there the dominant term is actually making sure you've got the loads matched up. But here's an example of some very, very usable correlation. So actual is colored, simulated is black. So we've got speed, throttle, steered angle, front dampers, rear dampers, lateral and longitudinal G. Now, this I used for a gentleman driver to help them dial in things like suspension geometry and dampers, and that worked really well. And here's why I say the biggest trap for young players is that you get months lost in getting the perfect correlation, which is great for impressing team, managers. It's great for selling simulators. Problem is that when it comes to correlation, it doesn't have to be absolutely spot on for you to be able to use it effectively. And that graph there is a really good example of that. So I really want to make sure that you guys keep that in mind. The other trap for young players is traditional approaches to simulation. Now, typical approaches to simulation is you set up a model and then you run thousands of simulations iteratively. Now, approaches like finite element analysis, CFD to a lesser extent, but I am more than happy to be corrected on that one by the good likes of Willem Towert, Ray Leto, and Andrew Brilliant on that one, and pseudostatic lap time simulation. So that lends itself to setting up a model, doing thousands of sims, and then just going through and cherry-picking what the good results are. Now, the reason you can get away with it is that your boundary conditions are actually really, really well-defined, and your changes in that environment are actually relatively continuous. And that is why that approach works really well for your more, what I would call, traditional approaches to simulation like FEA, CFD, pseudostatic lap time simulation. And even when you're doing things like track replays, where, say, for example, you're using a transient track replay, whether it's using the ChassisSim track replay simulation feature or something that's equivalent, to do a whole bunch of track replays and say you're changing things like your damper settings to see how the contact patch load variation is going to affect that. Another example of that is the shaker rig toolbox within ChassisSim. Now, for that approach, that sort of running 1,000 sims and then cherry-picking your best results, that works really well. It doesn't work very, very well for transient lap time simulation because it's a fundamentally different animal. The following sums this up in a nutshell. Now, here's an example of a rear spring change that I did for a V2V class car. And as we can see with the variance, if you take a look at the second plot that is speed, you're not seeing an awful lot of difference. But if we take a look at the C time, you're seeing, okay, it's getting a little bit better here. We lose a bit of time here, but however, we're gaining it here, but we lose it here. Now, that's an example of actually of a good simulated change because of the fact that the C time is very nice and continuous. However, what this does show is that with transient lap time simulation, when you're using a transient model to try and predict maximum performance, the reason it's a very different animal to things like FEA, CFD, pseudostatic lap time simulation, and track replays is that in this particular instance, one change is connected to multiple variables. Let me give you an example of that. Let's just say we do a rear spring change, which is one of your easiest go-to changes at the track. Now, on paper, you'd think, okay, in particularly in the pseudostatic world, you'd go, okay, change this, say, from a 500-pound spring to a 900-pound spring, then in the pseudostatic world, you should see a clear minima or maxima or a clear trend. In the transient world, that, in addition to affecting the static grip, now affects things like your damping response. It also affects things like your transient response, particularly as you're going into and out of a chicane. So consequently, things become murkier. They don't become wrong. They just become a little bit murkier. And that really sort of brings me to the next topic of how you actually employ this. And here's the trick, ladies and gentlemen. You've got to treat this like any test session. And you start with a weekend replay, and you carry on extending this out, treating this like a petri dish to see what did what tallied with this. And indeed, I must thank my Australian dealer, Pat Cahill from Competition Systems, for that analogy, because I think he expressed it a lot better than I did. And one thing that is absolutely critical, ladies and gentlemen, you've got to record this like any test session. And indeed, I would strongly recommend that the run sheets that you would have for running the car on track is exactly the same tool that you would employ for using the transient lap time simulation in ChassisSim. It's absolutely no different. Okay, when do you use setup sweeping and optimization? And let me, before I get into the meat of this, let me sort of preface this by throwing in a few war stories / historical context. First things first, one of my competitors, Chris Van Rooten, who was responsible for Bosch's lap sim. Now, Chris and I, we don't agree on a lot. However, there are two areas that we are in absolute agreement on. Number one, that the current Pajaca model is incredibly unwieldy is because the late Professor Hans Pacheco was always under pressure to publish, which under academic pressure to publish, which is why the Pacheco model got as big as it did. The other area that we agree on is that you just shouldn't be doing setup sweeping willy-nilly. Like, and Chris was actually very, very open about this in a presentation he gave at Professional Motorsport. I think it would have been either 2018 or 2019, my memory serves me correctly. And the reason you do, comes down to the fact that you only do this once the model is sorted. And indeed, when we rehashed the setups, when we redid the setup sweeping in ChassisSim and ChassisSim version 3.3.1 and above, we did this in such a manner that you are forced to interrogate what the data is doing. And every time you do a setup sweeping run in ChassisSim now, it actually logs the data file, and it logs the lap time, and that is there for a very deliberate reason. It's there to force you to look at the data so that you can actually interrogate it. And that really sort of brings me to the topic of when you use setup sweeping and optimization. You only do this once the model is sorted, and you only consider the ranges you have modeled. I cannot stress those two points highly enough. And indeed, in my master's thesis, which was the birth of the ChassisSim optimization feature, I pretty much did it for my optimization. I pretty much did that for my master's thesis. Applied it a few times when I was looking for some direction to go to very early on in my career, then promptly forgot about it. It was only until some customers started to use it that I sort of went back and tweaked it a bit. But that really rams home the point of that you only really use this once the model is sorted and you only consider the ranges you have modeled. The other thing that I also want to ram home is you're on the right track is when you see simulated changes like this. This represents a good change that you should apply to the car. So what we've got here, this was some work I did on the NA Autosport Evo 6 time attack car back in 2016. When we were exploring the front dive plane changes. Now, I did this at midnight, and my first thought was when I saw a 2-second lap time gain, my first thought was something was wrong. But when I looked through the data, if we take a look at this data, take a look at how consistent all the changes are. They're consistent everywhere. That, ladies and gentlemen, is when you know you are on the right track. And indeed, let me also add the flip side to this. If you're in a situation where you're throwing a whole bunch of sims at stuff, and particularly using something like ChassisSim, and the results are really bouncing around quite a bit, and there's no clear trend, that indicates two things. Number one, either the model isn't sorted, or number two, that you're probably in a dead zone in the setup. So that's really two very, very important things that you've got to keep in mind. But when you see something like that, particularly when you see a C time like that, that is manna from heaven. That's your green light to put on the car. And indeed, to quote one of my old motorsport mentors, Brian Ireland, he was my race engineer when I was working in Team A1GP China. He just said, if it makes sense on the track and it makes sense on the car and it makes sense on the simulator, they are your three green lights. And that's actually a principle that I adopted from Brian, who's, well, quite frankly, been doing motor racing longer than I've been alive. Anyway, so to wrap things up, conclusions and some reflections. Okay, transient lap time simulation is a different animal to its contemporaries. And the reason for this revolves around our boundary conditions. Now, in transient lap time simulation, multiple variables are connected. That is why it's a fundamentally different animal. Now, just like with the actual car, you have to treat this as a glorified test session. And lastly, with setup sweeping, you only do this once the model is sorted and you stick to the areas that you have modeled. If you can keep that in mind, you are well on your way. And at that point, let me wrap things up. And for those of you who are already involved, who are already in the ChassisSim community, put that into practice. For those of you who are sort of sitting on the edges there, give our online simulation a go and practice it for yourself. And we'll catch you in the next episode of Dan's Vehicle Dynamics.